Hello again, this is Dr. Mikola Rashik of Neurogenomics making another update video on mRNA vaccines. And today's video is a bit of an addendum to last video. And specifically, it will talk about a new theory that's been proposed earlier this year, how SARS-CoV-2 virus could be potentially leading to damage of our DNA. And it completely took me by surprise. It blew my mind. So I wanted to share this with you because it's really, really interesting hypothesis. And as a hypothesis, there's not even any experiments demonstrated. It's all based on modeling. And we all know from recent history how accurate modeling can be, if you know what I mean. So let's not jump to any conclusions, but the hypothesis of how the virus could be contributing to damage of DNA is definitely very interesting. So I want to share that information with you. But first, thank you very much to everyone who has subscribed to the channel. There's been an overwhelming response and support from last video. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. This definitely made things much more exciting and interesting. And thank you to also everyone who disagreed and also did not like the information in that video, for using that channel as a safe space to state your comments and having the courage to say that, especially since the vast majority of those disagreements were voiced in a kind and respectful manner, and this is exactly what we're looking for. It clearly is not possible for me to be able to answer all of the questions being posed, so as a response, my marketing director had an idea to start creating a vaccine Q&A session, so we want to be able to give away a whole bunch of free tickets to that. The information on this will be in the description, and stay till the end of the video to find out more how you could be getting the tickets. So now let's go to the study. Before, it's quite complex, so before I explain the hypothesis, let me give you a bit of a background. So recall that DNA is housed inside a nucleus, inside our cells, and think of the nucleus as like a brain of the cell. It tells the cell everything what to do, while the cell relays the information from outside environment into the nucleus. Nucleus will process that information and then it will tell the cell how to respond. So think of the DNA more like a repository of information. So think of it almost like a filing cabinet of information. In order to relay action from inside the nucleus, you need to copy fragments of the DNA. And when you copy those fragments, that's what RNA is. And you produce thousands upon thousands upon thousands of these RNAs all the time. And they have extremely versatile functions, RNAs. They can, some of them function on their own accord, but some of them act as a template to produce specific proteins. And think of proteins as tiny little molecular robots that end up doing all of the work inside our cells. And such RNAs are called messenger RNAs or mRNA. And that's exactly how vaccines work, because vaccines deliver mRNA information inside our cells, and our cells are not any wiser at that moment where that mRNA came from. They just simply use that template to produce a specific protein, in this case a spike protein, in order to eventually use that protein to stimulate our immune system to respond against spike protein. So that's the magic behind these new mRNA technology vaccines. But here comes the cracks of the information, not the mind-blowing part yet. Because we produce so much of these mRNAs inside the nucleus, they have to be taken outside the nucleus into inside the cell. That's called cytoplasm, and that's where mRNAs are actually then translated or used as a blueprint to produce those proteins. It's inside the cell, so they have to be transported out. But there's also proteins that are needed to interact with mRNA in order to prevent mRNA from being able to re-interact with the DNA. And why is that important? Apparently, if an RNA were to interact with the DNA in such a way, it could disrupt the system, weaken the system, where it would bind the DNA and potentially lead to breakage of the DNA. So the way that the cell deals with that potential problem is that when an RNA is produced inside a nucleus, before it's transported out, specific proteins bind to that RNA to prevent it from being able to re-interact with our DNA. And the way these proteins achieve that is that they bind to a specific code on the RNA. So RNA, remember, is just made out of four different chemicals with their arrangement of which is the information. And certain proteins will recognize a very specific arrangement of these chemicals, these bases, and will bind to the RNA and then prevent it that way from interacting with the DNA and therefore prevent any potential induction of DNA damage. So that's the background. That's crucial to the story. Now comes the mind-blowing part. So how does that relate to the SARS-CoV-2 coronavirus? Well, when you're infected with the virus, remember that the virus replicates itself over and over and over. Tons of it are produced, like tons and tons. And also recall that the SARS-CoV-2 virus, that genome is made out of RNA. And what these authors basically reminded us is that SARS-CoV-2 RNA virus actually has sequences embedded in it to bind those same proteins that we need inside our nucleus to prevent our own mRNA or RNA from binding back to the DNA. And as a consequence of that, SARS-CoV-2, because it's duplicated inside our cells post-infection to such enormous extent, it can actually start stealing those proteins away. So they are not capable of going back into our nucleus and do their proper function of protecting our DNA from damage. So as a consequence, there's not enough of these proteins inside our nucleus, and the mRNA that we normally would be producing can then re-interact with the DNA and cause its damage, lead to breaks within the DNA. And when that happens, so much damage could potentially occur, so much damage could be introduced that, and here is the wild part as to why authors think the virus might have used this as an evolutionary advantage, is that when you create enough of a damage in a rapid succession in the DNA, the cell will be overwhelmed, cannot fix it, and it will introduce or induce the cell to commit suicide. That's called apoptosis. And the authors posit that perhaps that's a virus's evolutionary trick to induce so much DNA damage so that the cells will die and burst and release everything outside, including the virus. So think of it like a piñata. If you hit a piñata, everything from inside is released, and that's exactly what would happen if a cell is committed to die and commits suicide. It bursts and releases everything. That also includes a release of the DNA material as well, which would then all be all cut up. And that might be a trick that the virus uses in order to make it easier for itself to propagate or to spread to and infect other cells. So really, really neat. So it's an indirect way of how a virus could be leading to damage of our DNA. So of course the question is, well, could vaccines be participating in this process? And luckily for us, authors actually did decide to address that topic as well. And remember, again, this is all hypothetical. They just produced some modeling in terms of measuring the quantities, whether this could be possible in reality or not. We don't know at all if this is real. And they suggested that the mRNA vaccines also have those binding proteins for those nuclear proteins. So if there were enough of them, then perhaps they could be also stealing enough of those proteins to introduce DNA damage as well. But again, that's completely, there's no confirmation from any studies. That's just simply a suggestion. So the answer is we do not know. And remember, spike protein is only a fragment of the full viral genome, so the virus genome would have a lot more binding sites. Nevertheless, spike protein itself is a very large segment of the genome, so the gene that codes for spike protein. So the answer is we don't know, and we should probably figuring that out. So that's the mind-blowing part of how basically virus could indirectly be destroying our DNA to make itself free out of a cell and infect other cells. Now I wanted to bring this back into my own world as well, which is basically medical DNA testing. And I can tell you that when a cell dies and releases its fragmented DNA, just like I've been describing here, we already use this in medicine. So we use this in non-invasive prenatal testing. So that's where you analyze the fragments of DNA released from placental cells to see whether the fetus is developing correctly. We also can use this in cancer. It's called liquid biopsy, to see whether, for example, cancer remission might be occurring. And if you're interested about these topics, I present webinars on these every month. But there's so much more information that is emerging, what we can possibly learn from these fragments, and it's absolutely stunning. So for example, by looking at these fragments of DNA, you can learn about disease state of an individual. You can learn about which genes are being used by the cell. If you look at the epigenetic information that's encoded on top of those DNA fragments, you could learn which tissues that DNA comes from. So you could actually in the future be identifying which tissues are contributing to cancer, for example. And that's not yet used in medicine, but it's just at the frontier of that. So it's likely going to be used in medicine in not too distant future. This is the really, really exciting part. So I wanted to share that information to relay it back into my world that I normally love studying. All right, if you made this far, thank you so much. I wanted to tell you about some of the seminars I'll be presenting. So number one, I'm about to present a seminar that I've been working with a couple colleagues for a very long time. There's three experts that are getting together to discuss holistic well-being. So we have a psychologist who will be talking about mental health well-being. We have a financial advisor expert who will be talking about financial well-being, and I'll be the third arm, and I'm talking about the health well-being, as you can learn from medical DNA testing. So if you're in Alberta, email me, I'll send you free tickets for sure. We're just very excited about introducing what we thought would be a very neat program about how can you take care of your well-being in a very broad manner. The other presentation that we're planning to have right away, as what I already mentioned, is the vaccine Q&A. So we're going to basically talk about, answer some of the most commonly asked questions as it relates to vaccines, and we're going to open the floor to any other remaining questions that there might be. And I want to give 50 free tickets away. So anyone who subscribes to Merogenomics newsletter will send you a free ticket. So the first 50 people who subscribe, you'll get those free tickets. And if you already recently subscribed and still would want to attend, just email me and we'll send you a free ticket. We just want to have a nice small gathering with safe space. So thank you very much for your time, and if you like this information, again, give us a like, subscribe to the channel. You know, we like it, you know, YouTube likes it, and most importantly, hopefully you like it as well. Thank you very much, and see you next time.